In the previous video, I told you that equations of motion of a point particle and its action, which is equivalent, do not have to be added as something independent of the Einstein equations in general relativity. On the contrary, they follow from the Einstein equations, in particular from the consistency condition of the Einstein equations that the divergence, the covariant divergence of the left-hand side is zero automatically, because of the Biak identity, and then the right hand side has to be also zero, and this implies that the equations of motion of the fields have to be satisfied. Okay, so now I'm going to illustrate explain this statement in this video using the point particle, and first we need the energy momentum tensor of the point particle to impose this consistency condition. In order to compute the energy momentum tensor of the point particle, what I'm going to do first is to rewrite the action of the point particle as a space-time integral instead of just an integral over the world line. This is easy if one introduces a delta function this way. So we will have d for x, dxi. Okay, introduce this square root of g for convenience, and then we have minus mc, this is part of the standard action, okay, which is still here, and the thing that I am adding is this Dirac delta 4, and this Dirac delta is has as argument the four x's of space-time and the four x's which are the coordinates of the world line. Okay, I am multiplying by the square root of g here, and I am dividing by the square root of g here. So basically, I multiply by a Dirac delta function, and I integrate over the whole space-time, and that's it. Then, we just have to use the definition of the gravitational energy momentum tensor. This will be a function of these x's, which are the coordinates of space-time. And in this case, I want to write it with factors of c, which I usually set equal to 1. Also, the sign here is plus because I am varying with respect to the metric and not with respect to the inverse metric. And this is because what appears, here is just g mu nu and not the inverse. Okay, so if you do this, take into account this factor of g, what you find immediately is minus mc squared, the integral of xi of x, sorry, x dot mu x dot nu divided by this square root of g x dot, and this d4 x minus x divided by the square root of g. Okay, so now everything, all that we have to do is to impose that it is conserved. If you wonder if this result is correct, you could think on a point particle as a particular case of a perfect fluid with pressure equal to zero and with a density of energy given by mc squared and this delta function. Okay, this S is the proper time. Okay, you see this is density which is point-like and it is localized along the world line, and it is zero everywhere else. So the energy momentum tensor will be, according to the prescription, minus rho, which is this quantity, ds delta 4 x minus x divided by the square root of g, and the unit vectors u mu and u nu. But this for the particle is just x dot mu, x dot nu. And it is clear that here in this expression everything is expressed, is parameterized by the proper time s. Well, I'm writing here s, sometimes I write tau, but here is s, which would be c times tau. I am here taking this c different from 1. And the difference with this equation is this factor, which becomes 1 when psi is equal to s. So the meaning of this energy momentum tensor is clear. It is the moment, the energy momentum of a particle, a single particle, moving in space-time along the world line x mu of s, or x mu of psi if we parameterize it in general. Okay, so remember that for a perfect fluid, the equations of motion, the generalization of the Euler equation and so on, were obtained by demanding that the divergence is zero. And here in this case, in the context of general relativity, we have to impose that this covariant divergence is zero. Okay. This is what we are going to impose. If I multiply by square root of g, this, I think this calculation I did in a previous video, so I do it very quickly. Okay, this is just this. And have t alpha beta. This is the thing that we have to compute. And because, well, you will have a square root of g and t here and here, let me put these two things together, because just visually you see these two things always pair. Okay, so let me first compute square root of g t mu nu, and well, coming here for instance, realizing that there is a square root of g here. Okay, well, this is nothing but minus mc squared d psi x dot nu, this is square root of x dot, and delta for x minus x. Next, we take the divergence. Okay, since this doesn't operate, this partial derivative doesn't operate on psi, then on the limits or anything like that. It comes inside and only acts on the delta. Now, see that we could use the chain rule, but then this derivative would act on this x instead of this, and this would imply a change of sign. So this is plus x dot nu remains here, this square root remains here, and because of the chain rule you can write this. Okay, the next thing is to integrate by parts. Okay, and we have the total derivative x dot nu divided by this square root delta for x minus x minus the derivative with respect to psi of x dot nu divided by this square root, and everything multiplied by d for x minus x. Okay, with this we have computed this first term. Now we have to compute the second. So it will be minus mc squared. Let me write it first. So it is square root of g t alpha beta gamma alpha beta nu equal to minus mc square psi, and here I'm using it, this is alpha beta, so this is x dot alpha x dot beta divided by this square root gamma alpha beta nu, and then delta 4 x minus x. And now we put everything together, so we add these two terms, and the thing that has to be zero is mc square psi. And okay, let me first put these two terms here. This is d psi x dot nu over this square root plus gamma alpha beta nu x dot alpha x dot beta divided by this square root, and all this multiplied by delta 4 x minus x, and then a total derivative that if we integrate will give us mc square, and then x dot nu divided by this delta 4 x minus x, and this xi between the same minus infinity and plus infinity. This is the part, okay, this is, has to be equal to zero. And you may understand this last term as the indication that this particle goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. You can say that there is a source of a particle in minus infinity and a sink of a particle in plus infinity. But this part is really not very interesting for us. And now you're going to tell me that this is not very rigorous. And I will say, yes, it is not. I have to find a better argument to cancel this. But okay, let me just work with this for the moment. And the conclusion is that this will be zero if this is zero. And this is the geodesic equation in a generic parametrization. As you know, this is equal to zero. Okay, ignoring this problem with the sources at plus and minus infinity, which from my point of view follow from the fact that this is just a very, very idealized representation of a particle, which is all the from minus infinity to plus infinity in space-time. Okay. In any case, when you do these things more rigorously, if you want, you can do this for more than one particle, and the conservation of the energy momentum tensor will include the interaction between the particles. The particles will no longer move along geodesics because there is an interaction between them. Okay. They are geodesics if you can include the effect of the gravitational field of the particles in this background metric, okay, but you see that this is this model is idealized also from the point of view that the metric that we are including is a background metric, and the particle does not contribute to this gravitational field. This is something that we don't know very well how to do. So these are the limits of this approximation of this idealized model. You can do much better, but there are always restrictions and limitations. Okay, this was the simplest case. We can do something else, a bit more complicated if you want, which would be to add an electromagnetic field to the system, and suppose that our or particle also has a charge. This is equivalent to including an electric current. This electric current will be given by this expression. So not only there is an energy momentum tensor localized at the position of the particle, but there is an electric current, and this electric current is given by this. Of course, you can do this also in Minkowski spacetime. You will run into the same difficulties. If you try to find if this current is conserved in Minkowski spacetime, so you set d mu equal to eta mu nu, and then you try to compute the divergence of the mu nu, you will find two terms like this, at plus and minus infinity. Because, indeed, the charge is not conserved. At infinity, the particle minus infinity, the particle appears, and at infinity, the particle disappears. So I think this is something that you want is a defect of this idealized construction, and you have to ignore it. You get the same result if instead of using the Minkowski metric, you use a general metric. This is done in the notes. But now, what we are concerned with is the conservation of the the identity that involves the total energy momentum tensor, which is now composed of two contributions. This would be the divergence, the covariant divergence, and there are two contributions. One is that of the electromagnetic field, and the other contribution is the energy momentum tensor of the particle. Okay, and the consistency condition tells us that this is zero. The energy momentum tensor, we have not written all the factors of C, etc., and we are now doing it, so we can rederive it from the action of from the Maxwell action. And the right normalization for this is minus 1 over 4 C times F squared. Now, it means that the energy momentum tensor for the electromagnetic field, now with all factors of C, is just F mu rho, F mu rho minus 1/4 of G mu nu F squared. If we compute the divergence, this is something that we have done. Okay. So we will be computing this first term. Remember that there is only one term that is proportional to the Maxwell equation, and the rest of the terms vanish because of the Bianchi identity. The Bianchi identity is something that is automatically satisfied, so it just tells you that those terms are zero. So we can just keep the term that is proportional to the Maxwell equation, and it is the first one, the one that you get by acting with the taking the divergence of this F mu rho. Okay. Then we can use these are field equations. Okay, just as we are using the Einstein equations, we can use the Maxwell equations. And the Maxwell equations tell you that now that we have a current, that this is equal to 1 over C times J rho, where J is what we have written here. Oh, we include this here, J rho 1 over C F mu rho, and then substituting the value of J that we have computed above, this is just Q times the integral along the world line of this delta function, square root of g f nu rho x dot rho. The divergence of the first term we computed before, so we just have to put everything together, and the result is that square root of g times the divergence of the sum of the energy momentum tensor of the electromagnetic field plus that of a charged particle is this integral, the 4 x minus x and minus mc squared. Now this is the proper acceleration. Okay, instead of writing the left hand side of the geodesic equation, and then we have this term that, as you know, is the term of the Lorentz force. Of course, we also have these annoying terms. Okay, but so these are minus infinity and plus infinity, but just ignore them. Okay, and the conclusion will be that well, we just recover the equations of motion of a charged particle in a gravitational and electromagnetic field that I'm not going to write again. Okay, you see the point here, there are different approximations. This is not extremely rigorous because we are using, on the one hand, these equations. Okay, and we are saying that F fills J, but we are not incorporating the effects of F on J immediately, because this equation is linear, after all. And we are also using the Einstein equations, where we are now considering the electromagnetic field, and we are including a particle. Here we are saying that this particle fills the gravitational field and the effect of the electromagnetic particle, but not vice versa. This is an approximation in which this is a test particle that does not modify the gravitational field. So this is really quite an approximation, and here there must be some C squared. Okay, so in any case, although this is not so rigorous, I think it is clear that the gravitational field has a lot of information about the dynamics of particles, fields, and everything, and that's because the gravitational field knows everything about the energy, and ultimately the motion and evolution of things is an answer to the evolution of the energy, and the interactions are governed by their energy. This concludes this alternative point of view of deriving the equations of motion of particles, and well, now let's move to the next.